Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Let's start to talk about the second section of funding, and this will be about long-term funding. So, when we were talking about corporate valuation, this friendly term of weighted average cost of capital, so what we were using to calculate or the present value of future cash flows, as using for discounting, was defined. So when you were writing test about it, and we were able to see that if it's lower, then actually it increases corporate value since it magnifies the value of future cash flows. If present value of future cash flows, if it's bigger, then actually it decreases the value of future cash flows, so that's why it's necessary to talk about it. And on the other hand, we know that if we would like to have some sort of assets, then we also need funding. Obviously, we can choose from two options. We can use debt, like external capital, which can be bank loan, which can be bonds, or we can use equity to fund ourselves. So we have to issue shares, or we have to reinvest annual profit to the company. And what is your debt than equity as a capital? Because there is one thing, and this is that interest payments are expenditures. So that's why if we have to pay interest, then it means that actually our tax payments will be lower, while at the same time dividend will be paid after taxation. Okay, and then actually the book says that there can be differences between the domestic firms and multinational companies, so usually the size of the company may be bigger, and okay, but it's one thing, but also the currency involved in the balance sheet can be also different. Also, they have access to the international capital markets, so they can go to the Eurobond markets to issue bonds in foreign currencies, in foreign bond markets as well, or they can issue shares on foreign stock markets, so they can be much more independent from funding environment at home. And actually this is valid for big companies everywhere in the European Union. So in many cases, big companies are never dealing with the domestic funding environment in the European Union. So they can choose and select the services of different banks on continental level. And exposure of exchange rate risk. It can be a problem if there is a currency mismatch. So if we have assets which are generating profits in one currency, and our debt is denominated in another currency, then it can be driver of a kind of an exposure, and it can be problems for the company. So it happened with the Russian airliner in the early 2010s, when the Russian ruble was depreciating a lot in 1 year, and all their debt was denominated in euro and US dollars, because they were leasing airplanes, and their incomes were realized in Russian rubles, so they had to be bailed out by the government. And exposure to country risk. Yep, but I think that this is highly general for all companies. So the specialty here for multinational companies is that you have more country risk than only one. Okay, and cost of capital across different countries. So country differences in the cost of debt. So first of all, there will be differences in risk-free rate. So if you are going to our great friend Stoku, then the risk-free rate in the US will be way lower than, for example, than the risk-free rate, for example, than Polish Epsilon at the same time. So we can see that, okay, but the speed should be the same. 30 year, please. Or maybe we can select 20. So we will see that obviously there is an interest premium in all emerging markets, so it doesn't matter if it's Poland, it can be Spain as well. Okay, for Spain it's less adequate, but still we can see that there are differences, or but it can be Turkey, which is going in the opposite direction. So so differences of risk-free rate will determine actually the lowest level of the interest rate, and all the other risk-related components will increase the interest for the company. But there are also differences in the risk premium as well, since it's also related to country risk. It's also related how the borrower is able to meet the obligation. So what kind of assets do you have in that specific country? Are you trusted? Are not? You are not trusted. How yeah, so it's mostly an institutional issue, and also cost of debt will be also affected, because if there is enough liquidity in the banking system, then obviously they can provide you lower interest rates. If there is a scarcity of liquidity, then interest rates can increase regardless that what is the underlying risk-free rate or risk premium at all. Also, for cost of equity, it's also based on investment opportunities in the country. So that's why actually competitor companies can be important, so how they will be allocated, and also not just companies, so competitor markets can be an interesting or important thing. So sometimes there can be even tax incentives to motivate people to purchase, for example, government bonds, because of, for all other savings or investments, you have to pay some sort of special tax. Or in many cases, people are saying that, oh, I don't want to purchase shares, let's purchase bonds instead of it, because it's more safer or relatively safer. Price earnings multiple, so this P per A describes that actually how the market estimates or rewards earnings, and in this case we can compare to the share price, and if some companies are above market average, then we can think that maybe there's a story behind that, or if they are under it, then they are punished for some reason. So we can have different sensitivity analysis, so relationship between project net present value and the capital structure can be analyzed. Trade-off and financing is done in developing countries. You can remember on the issue when we were talking about possibility of hostile takeover. So it was foreign direct investment. Or summer. Oh, sorry, it was somewhere here that is to use local funds, and yeah, borrow local funds. So in this case you can say that okay, you can get rid of your subsidiary easier because at least none of your international lenders will go after the company if something wrong is happening. So there is this trade-off, but it will be more expensive if you are using local funds. Funding for multiple periods, it can be a problem, but usually, at least in the European Union, IFRS is highly standardized, as I heard it. Comparing alternate debt and capital structures, yes, we can think about this. Assessing alternative exchange rate scenarios, they did it, I think, pretty well. Considering foreign stock ownership. Yeah. So actually listing the company of secondary or even tertiary stock markets to collect capital in different exchange rates, just it complicates things, obviously. So, after that, capital structure decision can be defined by the following characteristics. So, first of all, they have more stable cash flows to handle debt. Why? Because they are operating in different countries, and that's why they seems to be much more diversified than a single country company. They have lower credit risk. Actually, it's written nicely in the book. Mostly, we can say that maybe they have more acceptable collateral. But come on, if you have the same amount of asset in only one country, it doesn't matter. So, it's, I think that this part is wishful thinking. This can be reliable. But it's a nice idea that they have lower credit risk. I think that in the past we were able to see many international companies going down. So if you won't remember, then there was this section of cases of corporate defaults. There were some in the near past. So that's why I'm a bit suspicious at this field, at least, or pessimistic, or realistic. Highly profitable multinational companies are able to finance most of their investments with retained earnings. Or maybe not. So since we know that actually, so due to COVID, many companies started to face with the problem of this lack of suitable cash flows, and this was because mostly they were not keeping uh, cash flows on their balance sheet. So once COVID started, then they were hitten by it, and they were, it was way harder to survive because of lack of liquidity. And in many cases, we can ask the question that why didn't they have liquidity? So they had some sort of money, which, or you can say cash, what they earned in maybe 2 years ago. Maybe they had some cash earned a year ago, and also they have some cash what they earned this year, and also they have some other assets. And at the same time, you can see that there is debt. And there is equity. So the problem is that if you are starting to accumulate cash, okay, it's too restrictive, let's move this way a bit. So let's say this will be that, and this will be equity. So we can see that this has been reinvested in the past or recent years, and why not just sit on it? So soon, if we want to have an asset, or if we would like to purchase a company, then we will just use this and buy it. Why don't they just doing this? The problem is that if you are doing this and keep doing this, actually you can be the subject of hostile takeovers. Why? Because if someone takes up a loan, purchases the amount of shares on the market, so we know that maybe some part of this equity is listed on the stock market, and the rest is in the hand of investment funds, it's in the hand of the traditional owners or strategic owners. But there is always the risk that, okay, maybe someone purchases, let's say, 10% of shares. Now they have at least a package to delegate one member to the board, and they have to announce it. But if there is another 20% package, then they have way more. And actually, the problem can be that, okay, but if there are 30% of share packages which are starting to vote in the same direction, then maybe they can fire the management, and then they can go in and take over the company. And after that, maybe they can say that, okay, we were purchasing these shares from a loan. This is completely funded by debt. But since we have the cash here, so we are paying back the loan from this amount of money. So at the end of the day, maybe the entire takeover was completely free of charge, or it did not have to invest so much money. So it can be a danger. So to avoid this, usually companies are saying that, okay, if I have excessive cash reserves, so let's say I have some money from the last 2 years, Then I will not keep it as an asset. I start to purchase my own shares. Which is really good because share prices were increasing because the amount of traded shares will be reduced. And we have our purchased own shares in our hands. Which is really nice, just you can't do it for longer than 1 year, so in the next year you have to sell these shares on the market, or you have to provide some options for your managers or for employees. So you somehow you have to get rid of it, because otherwise you have to nullify or cancel this shares, so it would not work otherwise. And that's why we can say that retained earnings is a nice thing, but it can be also dangerous. Back then, the beginning of the semester, I was talking about it, and there will be a story soon about this as well. And Parent backs the debt of its subsidiary. It's really good because in this case you don't have to rely only on the assets of the parent or the subsidiary, but also you can use the credibility of the parent company, so it can make also business cheaper. Because banks will be really happy to, local banks will be really happy to provide loans, or even global banks, that they are able to say that, okay, we would like to follow our client. Actually, this was also a motivation for Central European banks to go to Hungarian, Czech, or Slovakian, or Polish, and other Eastern and Central European markets, because they wanted to follow their domestic clients. So it was worth them to purchase banks there to do acquisitions, not just because it was a growing market during the 90s and during the 2000s, but also because of this motivation was behind it. It's interesting that we can find also some companies which are saying that the subsidiary will issue shares on the local market. So actually, accepting cookies. In the past, maybe they had, if I remember well. Yeah, bonds. So we know that Hungarian Telecom is, for example, part of or owned by Deutsche Telekom, and also they are listing the shares on the minority share package on the Hungarian Stock Exchange, and also we can see that bond funding is, they are thinking about it. If I remember well, in the past also they were issuing bonds, so this can be an example for that. Country characteristics. Stock restrictions in the host countries. So sometimes you are allowed to invest into local stocks, but it's really hard to move to foreign markets. So you are locked in. Maybe you are not administratively locked in, just taxation motivates you. Or there are not enough service providers. It can happen as well, that the willingness to move. to foreign markets is also not that strong in the domestic investors. Interest rates in host countries, strengths of host country currencies, country risk in host countries, and tax loads in host countries, it can be important characteristics. Then, long-term financing. So obviously, multinational companies can consider domestic equity offering in their home country, which the funds are denominated in their local currency. Also, they can consider global equity offering. In this case, they will issue stock in their home country and most of the foreign countries. So you have secondary, tertiary, and so on listings. Just in this case, you have to meet all the legal aspects for the foreign listing as well. So last week I was talking about this Sarbanes-Oxley Act, which can happen if you are listed on the US market. Multinational companies may offer a private placement of equity to financial institutions in their home country. So maybe they are not public listing, just they are selling ownership. So in this case, you don't have to list yourself, you can avoid reporting and so on. In this case, it's a closed sale of shares. You have limited number of large investors and you can negotiate with them. Just the problem is that, yeah, but also you can be much more pressurized through your board if they are afraid of losing their investments. So it can backfire as well if you have major shareholders. Also, private placement, it can happen when they are expanding on some market that they are providing or selling shares directly to institutional investors on this market. Also, sources of debt, public placement in debt in their own country or global debt offering. Engaging in private placement in debt in their own country or in the foreign country where they are expanding, or they can obtain long-term loans in their own country or in the foreign country when they are expanding. Yeah, it's nothing new here. Cost of debt financing. So we can define the following highly obvious steps. So first of all, amount of funds needed. It has to be determined. Then forecast the price at which it can issue the bond. How? So maybe we are looking on Thomson Reuters database. We can say that, okay, here is Germany. There are the different corporate bond ratings. There are the maturities. So actually we can say that, oh, if we are rated double or triple B, in Germany, we can list our company at 2% of yield for 20 years. Maybe it's more expensive. So we can say that, let's say it's 0.2 for 5 years, which is preferred by this company. But we can say that, okay, if we are listing ourselves elsewhere. Yep. So we can say that, oh, it's 2.3. This is equal to this cube. Yeah. Wow! Market expects higher interest rates for the 1, 2, 3 years term. Also, we can look for, let's say, Turkey. No data exists. Okay. Let's say South Korea. It's really interesting that, so in this case we can see that the yield curve ends here at 3 years. So your companies are not able to sell, or there were not enough company or corporate bonds at this rating in the database to determine longer term, or the market just did not want it to purchase such bonds. So willingness of funding disappears here, but actually we can see this 4%. If you are looking at Mexico, no data available. This is sad. Egypt. Even less amount of data. So nice that it's included here. That's providing us the possibility to see that Russia. Error occurred. Thank you. Actually, here we can see something. Maybe I able to take this thing back. Very strange, it's not able to categorize, but here we can see the chart. So here in Russia we can see that, okay, this is the purple is A. This one is triple B. So it's and this one is triple A ratings for Russian companies, or sorry, Russian bonds, corporate bonds issued in Russian ruble. And we can see that this thing is so flat. Oh, it's interesting. In the case of US, we were able to see it so many times on the FRED database, so we can see the same thing. Actually, we can see this phenomenon that, okay, it's longer term, so you have to pay higher yields for that. And also we can see that the rating is lower than actually the yield will be also higher. So it's a nice illustration. Actually, I don't know why. I tried to add additional ratings, but that's all what Reuters can provide us. But it's still better than nothing. Let's see, UK, which is really preferred by foreign investors to issue their bonds, but we can see that also yields, long-term yields are way bigger than short-term, which is really close to zero. Japan. Sometimes loading in data is really woo. Okay, this one is highly unusual. I don't know what happened here. Central bank was purchasing enormous amount of corporate bonds in the triple B sector, and that's why someone was eating from that a lot. Okay, that's an anomaly. Yeah. But in all other cases we can see the same thing. So yeah, the steepness is positive, except this. And also, if you have better rating, then you have lower yield. So that's why this thing is completely irrational here. Maybe if you would check the news, then we would be able to see something which is, which makes this rational here. And forecast periodic exchange rate values for the currency denominated in the bond. Oh, on Wednesday we will be so happy to do this. You can prepare for that. The exchange rate risk. Financing with bonds in foreign currencies can be reduced by offsetting cash flows in high yield debt. So, if I'm raising incomes in Hungarian forint, then I can also have debt in Hungarian forint as well. Implications of the euro for financing offset cash inflows. If I'm billing in euros, then my debt can be also denominated in euros. So in this case, in both cases, we would like to avoid currency mismatch. We can have forward contracts, we can have currency swap agreements, we can have parallel loans, so which means that amount of income or the assets which are generating the cash flows or the cash flows are combined in denomination with the loan. Diversifying among currencies. This is what is not working at all. We should forget about this. Interest rate risk from debt financing. So first of all, debt maturity decision. So you have to think about, okay, not the Japanese case, but yeah, let's go back to Japan. Germany. Please. Ding. So obviously, yield will be higher for longer majorities here. But actually, we can see that, yeah, but the steepness is not that great for AAA. So we can see that, okay, I can issue, let's say, 5-year bond with 0.015. And for 20 years, I can issue it at 1%. Is this a significant difference? Absolutely not. So we can focus at 1% of interest or yield. So it doesn't matter. So actually, the steepness of the yield curve, what matters here, and mostly this thing. So after that, we can play with the time window, so we can play with the term. Actually, so precisely we should compare here the present value of such a bond which is issued with these conditions with the bond which is issued with this under these conditions. Just also you have to know that, okay, we are issuing under these conditions, maybe it's a fixed interest loan, and after that we are stuck with this yield or interest. And actually, I can be really happy if I have to pay even 1% of annual yield for my debt for 20 years, because it's a nice thing. So if you have to pay 10 or 20, then this can be a problem. So let's go back to Brazil? No, we don't. Chile. Yeah, we have Chile here. And we can see that, first of all, if you are not able to sell because there is no market benchmark, so maybe there is not huge quantities of single A corporate bonds in Chile. So after that, it's not that rational to issue long run, but also it's really funny that for them it's way harder to getting liquidity than on long run. Maybe for them some sort of liquidity shock is present. Because they need desperately money on the short run. And that's why it removes. Just in this case, corporate treasury is not able to issue longer term because it's, for some reason, it's fenced away for them. I don't know what is happening, but this is liquidity scarcity, a clear sign of liquidity scarcity for these companies, which means that lending in the banking system can be also affected because bank lending should stabilize this short-term part of the yield curve. Completely what is happening here. So if you are not satisfied with your, with the funding conditions on the bond market, then who cares? Let's go to the banks. So this, and this is single A. So we are not talking about junk bonds. It's still investment grade thing. Things are just floating. Obviously, LIBOR interests can be changing. They can change slowly. Sometimes they are defining that they are redefining this interest rate quarterly, on quarterly basis, on monthly basis. So it can't mean that on daily basis when LIBOR changes, you have to pay something more. But still, it's the resetting of the interest rate can be important or significant. Interest rate swaps can be used. Oh, it's so nice. So if you are setting the interest rate derivatives, swaps. This is just basis swap. And in this case, we can jump between different levels, so Ionia, okay, in this case we are in, so under the circumstances we are under the same exchange rate. But we can also cross currency swaps, which means that we can choose between two currencies and we can jump or choose two different German strange, but whatever, we can say that. Phew, it's so slow. So we can define that which currencies we want to include here. Then it's fixed, floating. How, when it's paying us, how it's paying us, what kind of money do we invest here, when the contract starts, how it ends, so, and also the zero curve can be defined here as well, so, yeah. So swaps can be great idea to deal with it. And after that, we can say that if you are increasing the amount of debt in different currencies, then we can have this accretion swap. So actually, notional value increases over time. We can have an amortizing swap. So as we are paying the debt back, then decreases. Actually, there is no accretion here. Also, we can cap and floor, so it means that the interest rate cannot go higher or cannot go under some levels. It can have constant maturity. Why? Yes, can't remember what was that. So in this case, for example, we can have the same thing for just the calculation of different present values will be modified. Now, basis swap is when we have two floating rate payments. Swaption gives the owner the right to enter into a swap agreement or not. Actually, I can show you also swaption because so this is the leg when you are writing out. And this is actually the premium, so the price of the swaption when this. So the volatility is on the receiver side. Okay, so then last but not least, let's talk about convertible bonds. So is there any kind of data since we are talking about this? Magnolia. Okay, there were many. Okay, that's more trickier than I was thinking. Okay, so let's go to. Let's go back. And let's say that would like to have asset classes. And convertible bonds. So convertible bond is usually so it can be it's a bond, but under some conditions. So maybe if the stock market reaches a level, or usually after some times, you have an option to purchase a defined or defined amount of shares for a defined amount of price. But until you get the interest, and after that still you can say that okay, I would like to keep the bond because it's I don't want to use the opportunity for converting my also something. There are not so many. There is not so many data about this. At least, let's see at least. New issuance. From the US. Reuters is still a bit slow. Royal Caribbean Cruises. So they were issuing this. Okay. So the coupon rate is 2.87. They were issuing some money. It was in US dollars. Let's see fact sheets. So what can we know about? Actually, this is what I'm interested in. Thank you. Soon we will see this. Okay. So was there any private placement? Yes, there was. So there are other owners. They want to issue more of this in the future. It's denominated in US dollars. Current coupon is this. And we have denomination. And that's all. Oh. Okay. This is not the most interesting thing, so let's go ahead. Workhorse group. Okay, let's see if there's. Evident protection. It's at 4% coupon rate. Conversion details. Yeah, so I was looking for this. So actually, we can say that this is how can we convert the bond to shares if we want this. This time period. For this share. We have a rating for that. I think that that's all what we can see here. Also, let's look for cacao. Okay, let's see what is this cacao. Now they got my attention. Cacao Corp. Is a 0 coupon putable convertible bond. Also, it has the conversion ratio and yeah, so the conversion starts only in the next year, and then you have the opportunity to do this. It's rated single A or triple A minus, coupon rate 0, Yeah, there is even a bid-ask spread, so difference between the bids and the ask. The yield is negative. So it's a newly issued bond, so we should not expect many new things, just it's funny to see that how they are different from each other. Okay, so convertible bonds. So let's talk about the Mall Magnolia story, because actually it was much more about removing unwanted shares from the market toward a hostile takeover than to collect funding from the market. So the initial problem is that if you want to refine Russian crude oil, then you need specialized refineries. So we can see here at this graph that there are different sulfur content and different physical properties for different types of crude oils, which is coming out from the soil. And also it determines that if you are near the pipeline, which is coming from Russia, then also you can build there your refinery. So it means that there is a small amount of refineries in the region. And mostly are owned by MOL Group, or by the Polish PKN Orlen Group, or by Rosneft. So this is how we can see this regional market. And also we can say that it's only profitable to move or to transport refined oil products within a 200 kilometer circle. So after that, margin is decreasing a lot. So what happened during the mid-2000s, that more shares started to increase in their price, while at the same time also the volume of trade started to increase as well, and market participants started to become highly suspicious about what is happening here on the market. So obviously someone was purchasing shares, and lots of shares, and in this case what happened in real life, that ÖMV and other investment banks, which were also asked by ÖMV, they started to accumulate shares. But all of them tried to remain under radar, so they never wanted to go above 10% of ownership. So they wanted to conduct a hostile, kind of a hostile takeover. And also at the same time, when the management realized that what is happening in the background, they started to accumulate shares as well. So this rally continued, and they wanted to dry out the market, because in this case sooner or later the public, the liquid market, will be reduced so much that actually there is no free or no available share for none of the buyers, and this is what happened. So yeah, the mall had enough cash reserves to do this. Just after that, you have to do something with your shares. They were not able to sell it, because in this case, ÖMV just sit there and would purchase shares for some money, and things can go on. So or the mall had to find a new buyer, and this was the Magnolia. And Magnolia purchased the shares from the MOL Group, and also at the same time they issued convertible bonds, and the notional value was 100 €1,000 per bond. It expired ten years later, and also they had the option to purchase more shares for a defined price after 2011. Until this point, they were paying 4% of interest, and later of them, when you can have this option, then it goes down with the variable interest rate. So here we can see it's a fixed one, and then it's a variable interest rate. On the other hand, it was not that rational to do this because after March of 2011, so there was this peak buy price, and we can see it's higher. So in this case, you can say that okay, let's use the option, let's sell the shares, and then it went down. So yeah. So maybe some investors were able to realize this, but this was not the success story. Actually, if we are looking on the current interest rates, then we can say that it's still a nice thing to have something like this, because bonds are not paying that well, and at that time even they were paying the same thing. So, but what is funny here that investors can be desperate sometimes. So more Magnolia bond yields were really low under the crisis, which was completely ridiculous because come on, more was absolutely not affected by the global crisis. Yes, oil prices were down, but the company was still profitable, and at the same time it was sold with a huge discount in prices. Yeah, so actually we can say that convertible bonds can also be used this way as well. So that was all, and next week we will be talking about financial lease contracts.